Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Ask Mr. Sutton if he'll give us our invocation, please.
If we can take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another fall day. Thank you for all the beauty that we have seen to date this fall. Help us all realize that it just didn't happen. Please be with us as we move into the Thanksgiving period of our holiday season. Please help us realize that we should be thankful every day, not just that day and on Sundays. Be with us as we deliberate the county's business. Help us make the right decisions for the future of this county, state, that have effects on the state as well as federal. Be with us as we go forward in our new year with our new board. Be with our military worldwide as they protect us and help ensure that we'll keep the freedom that we hope that we'll always have. Amen.
Amen. Okay. We do not have any public comments, so we will go to number four, the commissioner's responses, and I guess we don't have any responses because we don't have any comments.
Darn.
So next, Mr. Albright, if you'll give us the county line update, which we're talking about Orange County.
Well, with respect
to the floor.
With respect to the local bill and the let me slide this thing. Bruce and I have been working on this process now for nearly 4 years, and I'm happy to report that we've agreed on about 91% of the changes of where the line should move, which we think is a major accomplishment. With respect to our staff, we've met the administrative criteria for residential property. However, Orange County staff has come up with about 9% of the property that they believe should be moved to Alamance County for public safety reasons. The great majority of the changes will put property into Alamance County. So here's where we are. In your package, you have a proposed letter that Orange County drafted that we looked at. They intend to send those letters out to the affected Orange County residents and set forth the reasons behind the proposed change and make recommendations that both boards must approve, their board and this board. All letters and phone calls and expressions of public concern will be addressed by the Orange County staff, and they've agreed that any legal challenges will be addressed by Orange County and the Orange County staff. They've also agreed to pay for all surveying that's required. As far as Alamance County and meeting our criteria, I'm going to have Mr. Walker tell you about how many petitions went out, how many came back in. Give an update on that.
As of this morning, we had 47 people send in their petitions that wanted to stay in Alamance County, and 9 accepted the NCGS line. School forms, 8 total students from 5 households came in for Alamance County. Just as a comparison, and this could be a little off, but as last time I had a conversation in Orange, it was 16 people petitioned to stay in Orange, and there was 10 children involved in the school forms. Let's see. And so at this point, that's where we're at. On the 29th, we will be going over this in great detail for you. But again, we followed the criteria that you guys all agreed upon over the summer, and that's where we stand. So is there any questions on information? The overall acreage will be a 221 acres net gain for Alamance County based on what the current proposal is. So any questions on the stats? We're going to go over much more detail on the 29th, but that's where we're at this point.
Mr. Walker, a lot of people were jumping through hoops to do the paperwork and whatever they had to do. Do we have any answers for them at this time?
Which paperwork? Were you talking about the letters?
The letters and whatever they had
to do. Well, let's take a step back. You know, we've been through this 4.5 years, At this point, we had 11 requests for both counties about deviations or letters or whatever related to people that were not satisfied or we had come to this point. If you think about 11 letters, 11 complaints, that's pretty small. Now, the criteria was very, very straightforward, very simple, and there was, of course, going to be a few people that didn't fit the criteria, and those people, again, submitted letters. Again, Orange County will, on the 29th, will be telling about a proposal for that 9% that, you know, that don't fit that criteria, and they are going to, they, for safety reasons, they want to do a proposal related to that. And again, you guys will have to decide if that's what you want to do.
Was there, I left my packet, I was out of town and had my packet with me and I left it. Was there a map inside that packet of the proposal?
This one?
No.
I actually have the latest one. I got the, we've been back and forth with the maps and with their new proposal, I just got the map this morning. I have it over here on a roll if you want to see it. I certainly can give it to you. When you print out an 8x11, it's very hard to see. You know, I've had to make these large maps to show you. But I have that available if you want. I finished that this afternoon, so I do have that if you want. We'll get that to you for the packet for the 29th.
Anymore?
So at this point, we don't know where these people stand, the ones that did the petitions or did the paperwork or whatever it was that they had to do.
Well, the people who filled out, who qualified for petitions, okay, to petition the county, to stay in the county, the overwhelming majority of them filled them out and sent them in, and we got them. So those who qualified in Alamance County, they want to stay in Alamance County. It's pretty obvious. Ann Robinson's here, part of the 9th Street group. That was a big part of that group. So they have submitted all this stuff in, and we've got it in on time, and they're ready to go. We're ready to go in the next phase, which after the 29th, you know, then the surveying process begins if you guys come to an agreement with Orange County. So that's where we're at.
So would we be making that decision on the 29th?
On the 29th, you're going to be hearing, you know, doing the big dog and pony show, so to speak, on the whole proposal. You'll be hearing Orange County's on that 9%. Everything else up to this point has followed through on the rules that you guys agreed upon, again, over the summer. And so far, it's been pretty straightforward. So we're keep fingers crossed that this long journey is over. So
now, is that's not something we'll vote on that night, though, is it?
No. Orange County can't vote on it because they're right, outside of Orange County. So they have to be back in the county before the board can convene and vote.
And we're going to come back here to vote.
Right.
At our next meeting.
So you will have a new board.
December.
Yeah.
December. We'll have to get Mr. Manning up to speed on that.
What about the Tanger situation?
Actually,
the what situation?
The Tanger situation.
That was not a residential property. And I had received a letter, and I hope all of you got my response in regard to that letter. Their reason for moving the line in that situation didn't seem to make sense because in 2007, when they drew their plan, they had a line that cut through two businesses. And now the relocated line cuts through two businesses. So it just didn't seem to me to be the emergency and public safety reasons there that we had for these other residential properties that we agreed to move.
But now, isn't Orange County in favor of that move, or is that?
Mm-hmm. As of this point, that's part of their proposal, mm-hmm. And again, they're citing safety reasons and stuff like that. Again, their job is to propose that and to convince you as a board that that's the right thing to do on that 9%.
I guess we should say their staff is recommended.
Right.
We don't know what their board's going to do with it.
Right.
Not much different. What about Mill Creek, the lockdown area?
The Mill Creek situation was just the current Alamance County residents that fit the criteria. There was four properties, if I'm correct, that they petitioned to have the property go the line go around their property, but not that whole section. That's been off the books. So that was something that just didn't make sense.
And just to let you know, we're not trying to be hard to get along with. Our position as staff was that this board approved of administrative process. we were trying to hold to that administrative process as closely as we could, and we felt like, you know, that was the direction we got from this board. But again, if it changes, you know, staff has no problem to work with Orange County on that additional 9%. But we wanted that to come from somebody else and not us.
Right. I understand.
More questions?
All right.
Thanks, Kevin.
Okay. Resolution to appoint clerk to the board, Mr. Hancock.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. I would like to introduce this evening Tori Frank. Tori, after over 30 applicants and interviews, has been hired as administrative assistant to the manager, and she will be replacing Pat Jones, who will retire as of December 31st. And Tori is here tonight. Tori, if you'll stand up. We are thrilled to death to have Tori. Tori is a graduate from Guilford College, and she recently completed her paralegal degree. One of the most interesting things about Tori is Tori wants to be a county clerk. And that she took her paralegal to become a clerk. You know, she thought that would give her a bigger step in getting her foot in the door. And we're excited to have her. She's going to work with Pat again for about a month and a half to learn all of Pat's nuances. But we also I hope I said that right. She's going to teach Tori how to keep up with me and look after me. So that's going to take about 2 months right there. But we're excited to have her. But also in your package is a resolution that will authorize the board or giving her the powers to serve as the position of county clerk as of January 1.
And I will read that at this point. Okay. Resolution appointing Tori M. Frank as clerk to the board for Alamance County. Whereas North Carolina General Statute Section 153A-11 specifies and directs that the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance shall appoint a clerk to the board to serve at its pleasure. And whereas this board is of the opinion that Tori M. Frank possesses the requisite knowledge, experience, and qualifications to serve as clerk to the board for Alamance County. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance as follows, that Tori M. Frank be and she is hereby appointed clerk to the board for the County of Alamance to serve at the pleasure of the board, that this resolution shall be effective January the 1st, 2011, adopted this the 15th day of November, 2010. So do I hear a motion that we accept this resolution?
I'll make that motion.
Have a
second.
Motion?
Second.
And a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. You are hereby starting January the 1st, Tori. Okay, so next we are going to have the county manager report.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. Again, in your budget packet, or excuse me, your agenda packet is a outline for the Alamance County Fire Department's budget process and timeline. As we had discussions about fire department budgets at our budget process back in May, there was a fire tax increase for Hall River, and I think there was concern amongst the board about public input and making sure that information was given to people throughout the district, making sure that it was advertised, it was publicized, and that the public had an opportunity at the local level to make sure that they were aware of a proposed budget or any tax increase that may occur. Most fire departments do something very similar to what the proposal says, but it's not been formalized. So what this would do, this would formalize the process. Revenue figures would be given to the fire chiefs the first week in February. The fire departments would submit budget requests to their board because each fire district has their own board of directors. They would do that by the first week in March. And then after that, they would set up their own public hearing locally, very similar to what municipalities and what we have to do as a county as far as notice and advertising and making copies available to the general public. And then their budgets are due to be approved and submitted to county finance by the first week in April. We're asking that finance get an entire copy of the line item budget. In the past, only the fire marshal's office has been getting them. We're asking that they also submit one to finance as well. We're also asking that they submit copies of the public hearing notice or copies of what was posted on their website or their marquee or however they get their information out to their citizenry. And again, if a tax increase is requested, they're going to have to go into a little bit more detailed as far as the justification about why they're asking for it, and that must be signed by the board chair and fire chief. And then when it is time for the budget public hearing, they must have representation here to answer questions from the public as well as the board of commissioners about any proposed fire tax increase. I do want to thank Dave Leonard for all his help on this. We also met with the fire chief's council last Wednesday night, went over this proposal, answered some questions, but they were all unanimously supportive of this new process.
Now, will they show their budget, I mean, their
savings accounts, for the lack of better words?
Yes, sir. Their fund balance, yes, sir.
Everything? Okay.
Yes, sir.
What about equipment analysis? Dave, I know we're not trying to, I guess it sounds like we're trying to micromanage, but I think we need to have checks and balances. Are we going to be able to analyze whether maybe they're at, they don't have enough equipment or they have too much or?
Yes, sir. Each board that is over each fire department works closely with that fire chief and with those firefighters there to assist them in determining their needs and equipment and what is out there for them to purchase. So they have to put that up front whenever they're putting their budgets together. Mm-hmm. And that's when they typically bring multiple cost analysis in on each one of the items that they're going to purchase. So, you know, they have a fair standing as to what piece of equipment and the best deal that they can get and purchase it. But that's typically done through the fire service. They present it to their board as far as their equipment needs.
Right. Will there be any separate check and balance on our end from our office as to, I mean, their equipment and or whether we think, like, I think Drew Sharp was our, you remember Drew, and I think he went out and sort of came back and gave us a small report years ago on whether he thought personally, you know, based on parcels or occupied dwellings or whether it was land, raw land, and try to do an analysis of
all of that is done by each department as far as determining whether or not the need is there. Also their ISO ratings and for equipment that they need to make sure they're maintaining their ISO rating is typically what they're looking at when they're looking for.
Right. But what I'm saying is, granted their board's gonna think they're you know, they're gonna be proactive, what they think is proactive, but is there gonna be some separate analysis that we think from our office, from your office, that they might not need that equipment?
We can certainly look at, you know, what assets out there, what they already have, and what, like, we could do the feasibility studies for property and what they're protecting. Mm-hmm. But typically they have a better handle on it because they're working day to day within their,
I understand
their
that.
Jurisdiction.
I understand. It,
if they are asking for a tax increase, that is something we can look at and do some comparisons, especially you know, because that's what most of the increases are going for is equipment. We will be more than happy to do some comparisons and give you all that more detailed information when those requests come in.
Well, I would think most of the departments are very comparable. I mean,
yes,
we
sir.
Are a rural
typically
area
they
that
are.
They're
typically most of them have covering. Rural districts that they're covering, so the needs are pretty much the same across the board. We do have some that border some industrial areas where some of the equipment may need to be more specialized, and they have to address those issues too. And we certainly work with them on those types of issues and determining what is the best out there for them.
Okay.
That's fine with me.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Yes, sir.
If this proposal is okay, this is, it doesn't take a motion of the board, but we can, we'll,
it's
this
consensus
is.
On.
Consensus on that.
I think it's a good idea.
Oh yeah, better hope we hit
the right direction.
And I do have one other thing, if I could. We have an opportunity for a grant application for subsidized wages for temporary workers. There's a memo in front of your seats from Susan Osborne.
This is through the federal government, and it's through our DSS department. It's an opportunity to hire some temporary workers for 20 hours a week. The federal government will pay $6 an hour. We will pick up the additional $3 an hour. Well, our thought process is putting them in the maintenance department. Years ago, there was a county paint crew that went around for county facilities and did a lot of painting. We haven't had that luxury for quite a while now. So we were looking for, with the board's approval, hiring on three of these temporary workers. It would cost the county $3 an hour. That would be a total of $7,200. And really use it just as a basic maintenance paint type crew. And how we would charge this back was if DSS received, you know, so many hours of work, they would be charged that $3 an hour that they would pay back. So it would depend on who got the benefit from the laborers. But we wanted to make sure that if we did get funded for the grant, that we would be able to accept it. So that's the reason why we're asking for your permission to apply.
Didn't we have something similar to this not long ago?
Yes, sir. It was a short-term federal program, and this is an extension. There were some leftover funds. There are 34 counties in North Carolina that are eligible for this grant. the unemployment rate and the number of the percentage of poverty. And so we're one of the 34 counties that's eligible. But we did have it, and we put six folks to work here in Alamance County. We'd like to, with this grant, target fathers to build their work resume so that they can become employed, pay their child support, or take care of their children without further need from the government assistance. So this would be for 20 weeks, they would be employed in the maintenance department.
Then what?
The grant ends.
They're unemployed, or hopefully they'll find something else.
They are, but they've got a resume, something more on their resume that shows, you know, almost a half a year of work.
Do they qualify for unemployment benefits as a result of going through this?
I don't think so, no. And these would have to be TANF eligible, so they would be eligible for Work First. So this income would count and make them ineligible for Work First, so they would come off all assistance with this salary. So they wouldn't be receiving government subsidy for, you know, for Work First.
So. Do we need a motion on this or just a consensus?
Either or, just to allow staff to apply for this grant, and that if we do get it, I think one of the things that we have been told, they want us to make sure that we would accept it if we did apply and did receive.
There are 1,000 slots.
I request a vote. I voted no the first time, and I have to.
I'll put it.
I have to be consistent here. Okay. So.
All in favor of this?
Well, got to have a motion.
Okay, I need a motion, please.
I will make a motion.
Okay.
I'll second it.
Okay, I got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
It carries. Okay. Sorry about that. Okay, next is. You got anything else, Mr. Honeycutt?
No, ma'am.
Okay, at this, we got the consent agenda. Does anybody want to pull anything from the consent agenda?
Yes. Let's pull out A, B.
Right. I got it.
Excuse me. B.
B.
Yeah.
B. Resolution.
Resolution for quality growth. It talks about transit, regional transit. It talks about reinvesting city and town centers and sustained green space. I think this has not given me enough information, and I think the board should have more information before they take a vote on this.
It was forwarded to us by the Triangle Chamber, the Triangle Partnership.
Research Triangle.
This was all the information that they gave us. It was something they were asking everybody in the Triangle to approve and everybody in the region. So this was all the information that we received.
So, you know, we have no idea about cost or anything else. I would suggest that someone come and make a presentation at the next meeting so that you can make a good decision and vote.
Well, on the transit issue, I'd like to kind of just mention, you know, are we interested in that at all? Because the last time we put a vote on even participating in any at all, the vote was unanimous pretty much, except for myself, on the transit, so if we're not going to do it, I recommend we don't even vote on it.
Well, are you saying you don't want more information on this? Or, you know,
why bother if everybody's against it?
Well, we don't know what cost it bears. So that's my problem with it. What's the cost?
What's the political
all of it.
Motivation of all this?
We sent out the email to the board, and I think there was a request to put this on. I think it would.
Probably not paying attention.
So who requested it?
Linda.
That from Chairman Bassey.
Oh, yeah, because I got this letter from him.
Right, that we placed it on. So that was the only motivation.
Yeah, and I got this letter from him, and I did turn it in to Pat, and I don't know what the letter means either, basically, other than.
It is more of a feel-good type resolution than it is anything substantial. But you're right, there is no cost, there's not a lot of backup, but we were requested to place it on the agenda.
Yeah, when I got it, I said, well, let's just put it on there and let people read it and see what they want to do. But if I can make a motion that we see if we can get in touch with someone to come up and talk to us about this, would y'all like to hear that?
I'd like to understand more of what they're talking about.
Then I make a motion then that that we remove this from the consent agenda, and Mr. Honeycutt, if you'll see if you can get in touch with someone to come up here, I have that motion on the floor. Okay, I have a motion.
Okay, second.
I got a motion and a second, sorry. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Mr. Honeycutt, will you handle that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, at this point, I will ask if we can have a motion to approve the consent agenda after this one is removed.
So,
have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, now hang on.
Get your numbers right.
And now, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners and receive a report regarding the case of RS&M versus Alamance County. I need a motion.
So moved.
Have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?